Hallelujah, how we doing?
Or should I say, how y'all doing?
Who's ready to worship? Hallelujah. Lord God, fill our hearts. Let your presence fall on us as we worship your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I wanna see Jesus lifted high, banner that flies across this land, and all men might see the truth and know He is a way to heaven. I wanna see Jesus lifted high, a banner that flies across this land, and all men might see the truth and know He is a way to heaven. I wanna see Jesus lifted high. I wanna see Jesus lifted high. I wanna see Jesus lifted high. A banner that flies across this land, and all men might see the truth and know He's a way to heaven. I wanna see Jesus lifted high. I wanna see Jesus lifted high. Step by step we're moving forward, little by little we're gaining ground. Every prayer's a powerful weapon, strongholds come tumbling down and down and down and down. I wanna see Jesus lifted high. 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 I wanna see Jesus lifted high.
Hallelujah.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For His good is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, His love endures forever. For a life that has been reborn, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever. From the rising to the setting sun, His love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise.
Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Oh, forever. Forever. Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of a nation, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. Our God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. And now I surrender. God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world sing. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world sing. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. Our God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Unishikirene. Unamo. Ashakandarishikiro. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. Ushikoro.
Thank you, God. Thank you, God. It's at this time I'd like to invite you to receive communion in the back and bring up the elders for prayer as we continue to worship. You may go.
This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. And all I have within me, I give you praise. And all that I adore is in you. Give you my heart, I give you my soul, and I live for you alone. Every step that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me. This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. Within me, I give you praise, and all that I adore is in you. Give you my heart, I give you my soul, and I live for you alone. Every step that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul, I live for you alone. Every take every moment I'm away. Lord, have your way in me. High above all gods,
we exalt thee.
We exalt thee. We exalt thee. We
hands and sing.
We exalt thee. We exalt thee. We exalt thee.
Grab your name and say, praise the Lord.
Sunday to you. In the way of announcements, all you September babies, don't forget we're going to celebrate our birthdays after church. So meet me at the cake table about 5 to 10 minutes after church is done.
September babies.
I got a big praise report.
Yay.
Noah is home, so.
Yeah. All right.
He came home on Sunday night, and he's been working ever since. But, yep, he's home, so I'm a happy camper. Please pray for the Lancors as they're in Texas. Also, the Casaminas. I had no idea they were going to Japan, but they're in Japan. So pray for the Casaminas. Nobody knew. Nobody told me. Nobody informed the person that has to say announcements. But anyways, pray for them. Also, join us Wednesday night. It was a nice week of relaxation and recuperation for us, but we will be back here Wednesday night for our service, and then Sunday morning as well. And then, big praise report, last week was awesome on the 23rd. Ari, if you can show us some beautiful pictures from Grandma Aggie's service. It was a very beautiful service. They had tons of pictures. Look at that one on the left. It's so cute. So thank you for those that could attend the service for Grandma Aggie. And then we went on to CCI Family Camp the same day. Thank you, Ari. She also has a couple sneak peek previews of CCI Family Camp. So how many of you guys had an awesome time at Family Camp? Yay! Who's that? He's so dark. Oh, it's Kella. So who had such a nice time that they want to go again? So it's in the works. It's in the works that we do have a tentative date. I will inform you guys, of course, but Kiki, how many days do we have to go? Ari's really good at getting them on the how many days to go. So.
Amen.
But it's tentative, but in all faith, we're going to go again next year. Whether it be summertime or not summertime, we're going to go. So praise God. It was a nice, awesome weekend of new vision for our church, and just fellowship with each other. I enjoyed myself, and I hope you guys did too. And I'll see you guys next year at CCI Family Camp. Woo-hoo! Oh, also, we have now we're in the month of October, so you know what that means. Blazing Harvest. You're so good, Gabby. I might as well just give you the mic. Blazing Harvest is coming up on October 31st, so be in prayer.
As you can see, it's a part of the prayer request.
Be in prayer for our outreach on October 31st. It is a praise report and a prayer request at the same time. It's going to be on a Monday. As details become available, I will let you guys know, of course. So, without further ado, Josh, please take it away.
Do you guys get Halloween off anymore? No, figures.
My soul sings out as your word goes down far away. I sing to you and my heart cries, holy hallelujah, Father, you're near. My hope is in you, Lord, all the day long. I won't be shaken by drought or storm. The peace that passes understanding is my song. And I sing, my hope is in you, Lord. I'll wait for you when my soul finds rest. In my selfishness, you show me grace. I worship you when my heart cries glory, hallelujah, Father, you're near. My hope is in you, Lord, all the day long. I won't be shaken by drought or storm. The peace that passes understanding is is my song, and I sing, my hope is in you alone. My hope is in you alone. I will wait on you. You are my refuge. I will wait on you. Day long, I won't be shaken by drought or storm. My hope is in you, Lord, all the day long. I won't be shaken by drought or storm. The peace that passes understanding is my song, and I sing, my hope is in you alone. My hope is in you alone. My hope is in you alone.
And now our youth pastor will come to give the joke.
Get up!
Yeah!
Now it is. Anyways, I was talking. I guess Shyla has this joke because she likes it so much. But what did Winnie the Pooh say to his agent?
I don't know. What did Winnie the Pooh say to his
agent? Show me the honey. Jerry Maguire, everybody. For those of you who don't know it.
See, now, interestingly, they understood that one. Week after week, we don't get it. That one they got. It's good. That one. Oh, Lord, Richard. Pray for Richard. How many of you guys had a good week? Say amen. Complicated week, watching the stock market rise and fall, seeing all the stuff that's happening politically and in the world. There's no doubt we are in the end times. Anyway, everybody stretch your hands forward. Father, in Jesus' name, we pray over these tithes and these offerings that are not really money. Lord, your vision allows you to see the faith and the trust and the hope and the need that is in this basket. So, Lord, we ask you to minister to the need. We ask you to comfort and give peace to those that are praying. And Lord, pour out answers and pour out miracles. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Sorry, hang on for just a minute. I'm not quite used to this new mic yet, but I'm getting there. Anyway, Cleo's right. We had a phenomenal family camp, and the Lord spoke. The Lord spoke and gave us distinct vision, not only for what he's going to do with the world in general, but what he wants to do with this particular church. And it affects me, it affects the eldership, it affects the leadership, it affects our pastoral staff, and it affects you as parishioners. I believe what the Lord has shown us can impact your life and the ministry you have with the people around you in a way that we've never seen before. So let's pray and let's ask the Holy Spirit to not only help us review all four sessions of Family Camp, but speak to our hearts this morning in Jesus' name. Lord, we come before you and we ask you to speak. We ask you to speak to our mind. We ask you to speak to our heart. We ask you to drive our will, Lord, so that we would understand what your will is for us. Give us hope. Give us comfort. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said amen?
Amen.
Okay, so turn with me, if you will, to Proverbs 29, thank you, Josh, verse 18. Proverbs 29, verse 18 says, without vision, the people perish. So the topic, this is falling off again. Sorry, I apologize. Oops. There, can you hear that okay? Okay, I'm going to change mics in a second if this doesn't work out well. Yep, it's not working out. No, just give me the handheld one. Okay. It says, without vision, the people perish. Spiritually perish. Intellectually perish, physically perish, things end. The spiritual things that God wants, the intellectual and the emotional things that God wants, wind up vanishing. And what you wind up with people that have no vision, and specifically for people that don't have God's vision, is they lose hope, they lose trust. They cease to see God as relevant. They cease to see God's word as relevant. And as a result, they spiritually die. Their minds die. And they're not encouraged. They don't have the zeal of God. And you can see it in them. You can see that... Is this on? Okay. You can see that they aren't living a life of hope. They aren't living a life of faith. They lack conviction. When temptation comes, they just say yes. When compromises present themselves, they just rationalize. Oh, God's going to understand. Oh, God's going to know. Well, God knows that I love him, so he's going to excuse this. And basically what you have is a compromised, hopeless, non-driven, non-committed Christian life that lacks power because it has perished. And the reason it has perished is partially my fault. It's partially the church's fault. And that is, the people lack vision. Now, the word vision is the Hebrew word hadzon. And basically what hadzon literally means is mind sight. Something that the Lord has shown you, specifically God. God-given hadzon, God-given mindsight. Sometimes the Lord will speak in a very direct way. Shalei, I am sending you to the people of so-and-so to lead them to the law, lead them to the Lord. Sometimes he will show a picture. Richard Bowles has a gift of prophecy, and he's very big on what we call oracles, and that's found in Scripture. And that is God just showing a picture of a ladder leading up to heaven. In the case of Richard, for instance, he will have something happen to him where he'll say, I was praying for Kella and Jessica, and I saw a mango tree, and I saw all the fruit falling, and, you know, drop, baby drop was falling on the ground. And I think that means that the Lord is pouring out the fruit of the Spirit upon you, whatever. But that's the thing. Sometimes Richard will see the oracle, He'll see a picture, or somebody will catch a word, somebody will catch a phrase, somebody will be reading their Bible, like Sue is reading her scripture, and suddenly, you know, Isaiah 41:10 just jumps out at her. And, you know, she comes to Patty and she said, I don't know what was happening, but I was reading the Word of God, and, you know, I read Isaiah 41:10, and it just echoed in my mind, just kept clanging around in my head like a bell clapper does. And all night long, I can't, it's like a song that catches, you know, in your head. I remember when I was a kid, and I was watching Checkers and Pogo. You guys won't even know who that is. But, Rich, remember the I got to talk to a guy my age, you know. You remember the exchange goes down, 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 and around, round, round, in your tum, 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 makes your mind think, yum, 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 that orangeade called exchange, right? Well, I would hear that, and for 3 days, I could not get it out of my head, this stupid exchange orangeade song. Well, that's exactly what can be like when God gives you a hadzon, when it includes a scripture, and it just keeps going around and around and around in your head, and she may bring it to Patty. And the reason she would do that is because the Bible says, we know in part and prophesy in part. Say that with me. We know in part and we prophesy in part. And God, because he does not appear, generally speaking, in a cloud and give direction to somebody word for word, he wants to work and he wants to move through the body of Christ and through this church and through the members of the church to give a complete picture of what he's trying to say. But this is hadzon. This is what God wants to give you. This is what's missing in Christian lives, in Christian minds, is they read the Word of God sometimes, they listen to the sermon, but that's not a hadzon. That's not a vision. That's not something God gives you personally. God wants to fill you with vision. He wants to fill this church with vision. He wants to enable you to catch sight of what I believe God has shown me, what the elders agree God has shown us, and what we had firm commitment and agreement from the people that were at camp. So those of you that were not at camp especially, listen closely to what we believe God is showing the world, God is showing the world, God is showing the church at large, specifically is showing us here at CCI. Now, the topic for camp was the future. And we talked about the future of the world. We talked about the future of the church, the ecclesia, the bride of Christ. Then we started talking about the future of CCI and how it relates to your future. Every single one of our future that's here as individuals. And this is what the Lord is showing us. And the first part of it is no big deal. But the Lord showed me a vision of this church, this very building, filled with hundreds of people. And the people that filled this church were all pretty much between the ages of 18 and 40. And I saw this huge group of people, and I realized, I cannot minister to these people, I'm too old. I am, and I'm becoming, socially irrelevant for this group. I don't speak their language. I don't have their value system. I don't understand what they've been through. I don't have a common frame of reference. I'm a product of the 60s and the 70s, which sounds like ancient history when you talk to somebody of Josh's age or Shalay's age. So for me to be able to socially relate to them and understand the world they're in and minister to them as one of them, as you'll see as this message develops, that precludes me from being that much of an active part in changing and transforming lives that will fill this church. I believe the Lord is calling us as a church to begin to migrate to a place where people like me, Richard, Daryl, Joe, our wives, are mentoring, training up, supporting, helping, nurturing, and raising up the younger generation that we have in our church between the ages of 18 and 40. My friend Jeff Hamilton pastors a church in Orange County, California, and as an example of what I feel the Lord is showing us, His church is a very, very football-driven culture in the church. All His members are in football. They were in football, former football members, players, college or some NFL. And so the culture of the church is very much immersed in football, which helps him frame how he feels the Lord has shown him the church is supposed to run. And if you look at his business card, Kule, it doesn't say senior pastor, even though he is a senior pastor. It doesn't say Jeff Hamilton, senior pastor. It says Jeff Hamilton, QB. And his youth pastor is the fullback, or, you know, they all have these different evangelism. They're the wide receivers. And, you know, it's almost like what's on their card kind of describes the nature of how their ministry functions. But they also have a church council. We call them elders. I'm an elder here at this church, as are Richard and Daryl and Joe and our wives. And they call it a church council in the Foursquare world. And on their cards, it says coach. And they have older men, older women. And when I say older, the word used in Scripture for older is presbyteros. Now, what presbyteros means is not older necessarily in terms of age. What it means is older, actually literally means wiser. A wiser knower or a wiser holder. Somebody who has more wisdom. And next week, Sunday, we'll talk about wisdom and how wisdom is applied. But the presbyteros or the elders are seen as coaches. And here's the thing. Coaches do not get on the field. Coaches do not pad up. Coaches do not put on spikes. Coaches do not put on helmets and go bash and go throw and go run. Coaches teach. Coaches train. Coaches give the support, the comfort, the prayer base, the nurturing that the young ones need so that they can go out there and do the work that God has for them. Now, listen to me carefully. I took 2 minutes to say this at the 8:30 service, but I want to make it more prevalent in this message. And that's this. Daniel did it, and I'm going to do it. I feel like I need to, and my generation of believers needs to apologize to the younger ones. Because we were, when we were young, given a clear vision and a clear directive by the Holy Spirit as to what we were supposed to do and what we were supposed to accomplish. And the Holy Spirit was pouring His power out upon our churches. In the 60s and the 70s, there was a second awakening of the power of the Holy Spirit. And there was revival. And they were miracles. And tongues was common, and prophecies were common, and healings were common. And people like Oral Roberts and Rex Humbard, Catherine Kuhlman, later Benny Hinn, and people like that began emerging. And the power of God was evident, and it was being poured out upon us. And I was very aware when I was saved in 1979 that the calling had been placed on us and a mantle had been placed on us. But even by the time I got there in the 70s, it was starting to slip because something had eroded our vision. Satan had creeped into my generation of believers. And it was subtle at first, but what happened was this. Rather than take the power of the Holy Spirit and use it to glorify God and lead people to the Lord, we became seduced and entranced by the temptation to build huge, massive churches that were personality driven. It is a human trait to want to be a superstar and want to have attention and power. And with it came privilege, with it came money, with it came, I mean, when I'm talking about money, in terms of when PTL grew up, or when CBN grew up, or when TBN grew up, these TV stations, Lester Summerall had his own station that was based here in Hawaii. These are millions and millions of dollars. My pastors, when I was growing up, who went to Bible college in the 30s and 40s and pastored these little churches. And you know, Linda, there was a time when CCI would have been considered to be an average-sized church. People would have walked in here and said, you know, that's a very healthy church. I talk to your people, they're very loving, they understand the word of God, they pray, they're dedicated to the Lord. And I believe God has done great things in your congregation. If we crested 100 people, people would go, wow, yeah, that's actually, you should check that church out. That's a large church. Now you can have 500 people on your peewee. And you're treated that way, by the way. I've been a pastor for years. I was Pentecostal Holiness. I was Assembly of God. I'm now Foursquare. And it was never like this. Where if you have a church of 500 or less, you don't get to sit at the big boy table. Your opinion in the denomination does not make any difference, and nobody listens. Because all they care about is the vision that they caught a hold of in the late 70s, coming into the early 80s of mega-churching. And as a result, you saw the failings, you saw the fallings, Marvin Gorman, Jimmy Swaggart, Jimmy Baker, and the list just went on of big TV personality ministers who one after the other, financial corruption, sexual corruption, this happened, that happened. Over and over, it began corrupting. And what wound up happening, and what I'm apologizing to the younger generation on behalf of my generation for, is we failed you. We failed God and we failed you. The world we were supposed to turn over to you at this time, at the turn of the millennium and beyond, was a revitalized bride. Where respect for the church, respect for God, honoring the word of God, had reached new heights. Healing was common. The miracle working power of God was common. People were being delivered. People were being set free from all sorts of bondages. And instead, we have this, where people see the church and they think of it as a perverse, irrelevant, impotent organization that they don't give a rip about. When you talk to the generic person, and I'm talking worldwide now, not just here in Hawaii, between the ages of 18 and 40, they're not even considering church. They're not even considering Christianity anymore. They don't think about God at all. They think about Jesus Christ as irrelevant. And they don't see him as a valid alternative. And when they need help, when they need hope, when they need something to hold on to and give them strength, they don't think about running to Jesus. They don't think about running to church. Because they see it as the monstrosity that we, my generation, helped create. And justifiably so. So, in response to that, I believe God is starting, in these last days, a new move. Now, this is the vision. That the Lord is going to pour his spirit out upon those who come to this church, especially in that age group. And where the vision, the Hadzon, applies is to your pre-Christian friend, your pre-Christian family member, okay? And you all have them. And they're not thinking about Jesus, and they're not thinking about God, and that's to their detriment, and that is a desperately, in this time in history, horrible thing, because I believe, how many are in agreement with this? We are in the last days. Say amen if you believe that. Amen. Jesus is coming back soon. Okay, now the problem for the pre-Christian, and I call them pre-Christians, because I believe God wants to lead every single one of your family members, every single one of your friends, every single person you work with. He wants them saved. He wants them healed, delivered, and set free. Book of Peter says that God is not willing that any should perish, but all come to repentance. Amen? That means that no matter who it is that you know does not know the Lord, God wants them saved. When you pray for them, you are praying in agreement with the Holy Spirit. You're praying in agreement, perfect agreement, with the Word of God. Are you supposed to marry this girl? Are you supposed to marry this guy? Are you supposed to go here, take this job, move your house here? Those questions I don't know. Well, some of them I do, some of them I don't. But those questions aren't covered in Scripture. This one is, does God want to save your boss? Yes. Does God want to save your mother? Yes. Does God want to save your friend? Yes. Does God want to save your husband? Yes. When you're looking at that guy sitting over there, does God want to save him? The answer is? So, when I pray for him, and I do anything that pursues his salvation, I know I am in God's will. For these people, 18 through 40, God wants to save them. God does not want this to happen. Your pre-Christian friend, let's say this is the earth right here. And the earth is about ready to go through the tribulation, which is a part of the wrath of God and the last days. So there is a time of God's wrath that is going to be poured out. And it's described in the book of Revelation. It's described in the book of Daniel, Ezekiel, in allegorical terms. There are seals that are broken in heaven. There are trumpets that are sounding. There are thunders that roar across heaven. There are bowls or vials that are poured out that are much feared by everybody. And all of these things, there are seven of each of them, symbolize something horrible that is going to happen upon the earth that it will affect the people that are left behind. There are three huge disasters and examples of the wrath of God that we use to illustrate what's coming. During Noah's time, God sent the flood. During Lot's time, he destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. During Moses' time, he turned plagues upon Egypt. And if you study the seals and the trumpets and the thunders and the bowls, what you wind up, well, the thunders you don't know. He who was revealing these things to John told him, showed him what the thunders were, but said, you can't write this stuff down, because it's going to terrify people. It's going to send them into a panic. So you can't write this stuff down. The rest of it I'll let you write down, but the thunders, that you cannot. The combination of all of these things together, 4 times 7, in terms of the seals and the trumpets and thunders and the bowls, are a combination of those vehicles of wrath that God had poured out in Noah's, Lot's, and Moses' time. There will be natural disasters. There will be supernatural disasters. There will be spiritual attacks and consequences that will be poured out upon the world. Demons will be let loose, and the power of the occult will overcome, making it virtually impossible for anybody to get saved except for the power of God moving miraculously during that time. But these people who are pre-Christian, this is the default destination. Okay? If they do nothing, this is the default. In John chapter 3, verse 16, Jesus says something great. Very comforting, very awesome. He said, for God so loved the world, say it with me, that whosoever should believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. Nice, right? Follows up 2 verses later in verse 18 by saying, but whoever does not believe in the Son stands condemned already because they refuse to believe in God's one and only Son. That means if you don't believe in Jesus, you're already condemned. That's why I call this the default path. It doesn't matter if they live a good life. It doesn't matter if they mean well. It doesn't matter how sweet they are. And this is the spiritual reality that faces every single person who is in this category, regardless of their age. They will, by default, go through this time of wrath that is coming
in my opinion, fairly soon. And here's the thing of particular interest for those of us who live in Hawaii. In the first part of the first bunch of wrath, objects of wrath that are poured out, the seals, in the middle of the seals, there is an earthquake that shakes the earth so much it decimates a third of the planet, and every single mountain gets flattened to some degree. It doesn't go dead flat yet, but every single mountain is shaken and is flattened. But here's the thing, all the islands, how many islands? Are thrown into the sea. The volcanic stem that holds up each island, the tectonic movement of this earthquake is so violent that they snap, and the Bible says they get thrown into the sea. Bernie, you know what that means? That means that anybody in Hawaii, anybody in Tahiti, anybody in Samoa, anybody in Fiji, I don't know if it includes Australia, that you got to leave up to the Lord, but New Zealand is most certainly considered to be an island. All those people do not get to go through the whole tribulation. All those people do not get to watch the whole thing play out. If you're thinking, oh, eventually they will see as the Antichrist rises up and all these terrible things happen, they will understand that what I was telling them was true and they'll repent and they'll turn around. People in Hawaii will not have that time luxury. Because early on, any island dweller is going to be killed. And they'll die in their sins and they'll go to hell. And all this is happening relatively soon. If you doubt it or you have friends who doubt it, don't be surprised. Because in 1 Peter it says, in the last days there will be many scoffers who will come. And this is what they'll say. Where's the sign of his coming? What, are you kidding me? Jesus coming again? That doesn't even make sense. First of all, if I was Jesus, if you were Jesus, and you could go anywhere in the universe, would you really come here? Second, yeah, there's no miracles happening anymore. There's no healings happening anymore. God's dead. Time magazine said it. I believe it. That sells. It's over. And there will be scoffers, but this is true. Noah told them about the flood coming. They didn't believe him, and they were left out, and they drowned. They tried to warn the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah to repent. Nobody listened. Not even Lot, really. Even he didn't take it seriously. And as a result, they died. Moses continually spoke to the Pharaoh and said, "Set my people free. Let God's people go." And he refused, and the Egyptians refused. As a result, the plagues poured out upon them. And you will tell these people that you know God is coming, Jesus is coming, and these things are going to happen, and they're going to not believe you. These objects of wrath are coming up. Somebody say, praise the Lord. Because 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 9 says something else. It says, "For God hath not appointed us to suffer wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ." Now, all of this 7 years of tribulation is described in Revelation and Daniel as wrath. Everybody say wrath. This is God pouring out his justice upon the world and everybody who's a lawbreaker. But 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 9 says, "For God has not appointed us to suffer wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us," verse 10, "that whether we are dead or whether we are alive, we should live together with him." Think about that, Marilyn. Whether we are dead or whether we are alive, which is referring to the physical, we will live with him, which describes the spiritual. This passage contains a promise of eternal life comes as a result of believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Thessalonians 5, 9 and 10. That means that for this person, all these pre-Christians, there is an alternative. They don't have to follow this default. They can actually go this way instead. Now, what's the difference? For all these 18 through 40s that have been failed by the church, not God, and are out there waffling, God has a message for us. God has a message for CCI. Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 29 and following. The prophet Ezekiel is faced with a rebellious nation of Israel. They are ignoring the word of God. They do not apply the word of God. They do not go to temple as they should. They do not give the tithes as they should. They do not pray as they should. They do not worship as they should. In addition to the all these things that they should do that they don't do, there are a bunch of things that they were doing that they weren't supposed to. Adultery was rampant. Fornication was rampant, embraced. Homosexuality is not new, and it was not exclusive, by the way, to Sodom and Gomorrah. It was happening within the nation of Israel during this time, where this girl was going off with this girl, and this guy was going off with this guy. And there was a complete lack of application of the morals of the Word of God and Scripture. And here's the thing. During this time that Israel was in rebellion to God, the prophets were saying, don't worry about it. God is a loving God. He understands. No need to worry. You don't have to change anything because God will accept you the way you are. He made you the way you are. And the things you love doing and the things you like doing, just make sure you're thankful in your heart and give the Lord praise for that. But you don't have to worry about all this stuff because God has shown me that He's going to bless you. God has shown me that His forgiveness is so overwhelming and His forgiveness is so complete that you can do whatever you want and you don't have to worry about it. Because you are the nation of Israel, you are His chosen people, and He's going to bless you. Does any of this sound familiar to you? Is any of that similar to what you see happening in the generic ecclesiastical church that people my age have built? That's been founded on the flawed foundation of what guys my age tried to do and tried to accomplish. In Ezekiel 22:28 it says, her prophets whitewash these deeds. Not that bad? All you boyfriends and girlfriends living together, sleeping together every night, that's a complete abomination to God. Come on in here, sit down. You're welcome here. And there's no need for you to change. I talked to a fellow pastor of mine, and I heard he made a boyfriend and a girlfriend that are older, they're in their 40s, elders, church council members of the church. And I'm like, wait, when did they get married? Oh, they haven't gotten married yet, but they're praying about it. I'm like, what? He goes, well, but they really love each other, and we prayed about it. We feel like the Holy Spirit said, there, He loves them and He recognizes them leadership. I'm like, stop. You're putting me in a horrible position here. You're putting me in a position where I can't talk to you and I can't sit down and have lunch with you anymore because you are an abomination to God and you are exactly what this is talking about. We have this happening in the church around us. How many know that's true? Say amen. They whitewash these deeds. For them by false visions and lying divinations, they say, this is what the sovereign Lord says when the Lord didn't say anything. And they go on and they do all these horrible things. But verse 30 says this. Verse 30 says, for I looked for someone. This is God talking. This is Jesus talking. This is Jesus talking to you and I. This is Jesus talking to the CCI. This is Jesus talking to you as an individual right now, especially if you are between 80 and 40. I look for somebody who would build up the wall and stand before me in the gap. He's looking for somebody to build a wall here. He's looking for somebody who will build a wall here and stand in the gap. This is supposed to be you. Now listen to this carefully. I looked for someone among them. From where? From where? Among them. I looked for someone among them. I'm not 18 to 40. So in ministering to this age group, to ministering to this social strata, I'm not from among them. You can tell that very easily. My hair is wrong, the way I talk is wrong, the way I dress is wrong. But more than that, my attitudes and my value system and my morals make me irrelevant to this group of people. But Shalay is not irrelevant. Josh is not irrelevant. Gabby is not irrelevant. Micah is not irrelevant. Jojo is not irrelevant. Kalai is not irrelevant. Leanne is not irrelevant. Ari is not irrelevant. They understand and they know because they go through the same problems and the same frustrations as these people, what's going on with them. And here's the thing that I want to share with you that the Lord shared with me. There was a huge anointing that was poured out upon our generation, Richard. Marilyn, you saw it. The move that was in this church. This very building. But we failed to do anything with it and have any impact. Now, there's a call to your generation, younger ones. And I believe you have been left with twice the mess that we had in the 70s. And I believe, because the Word of God says, with the calling comes the enabling, there is twice the anointing that we ever had. That there is twice the power we ever had. That there is twice the blessing we ever had. If you will step up and you will embrace that and you will become part of what I believe God wants to do here at CCI, I believe you will see people healed, delivered, saved, set free, lives transformed, and changed. And God wants to use you, not me, to accomplish this. He wants you to stand up and say, yes, I will stand in the gap. Now, real quick, and I apologize for going over time, this is what standing in the gap looks like. And by the way, if you're older than 40, God doesn't want to sideline you necessarily. He wants to use you because, Jose, I see you're wearing your shirt. I should have worn mine today too. Good game yesterday, right? Where would those players be without coaches? Okay, they're strong guys, right? At least we saw that yesterday. Strong guys, talented guys, very capable guys. But let's say at the beginning of a game or beginning of a season, all the coaches just said, you know what? We leave it to you guys. Go ahead. Go do it. Go win. Rah, rah. We'll be in the stands eating hot dogs and Chinese peanuts and drinking beer. And you guys stay down here and go for it. How would that work for them? No plan of that. They wouldn't know what to do. Exactly what God is calling us to do. 40 it up to help these people. To give financially, to give of our time, to open our home, to spend time with them, pray for them, help them, nurture them, support them, instruct them, teach them, encourage them, so that they can do what they're called to do. One of the things that is obvious in the Barna group regarding this age of between 18 and 40 is they, to a large part, feel ignored and misunderstood by our generation. And they don't come to us for help because they don't feel like we know anything and we can help them with anything. That's got to change. And if it does, the anointing will pour out on us too to minister to them as the anointing pours it upon them to transform and change the world. How many say amen? Amen. This is what God wants to do. To stand in the gap. One last thing. What's a gap? That's a break between God and them. Between all, and especially I'm speaking to those between 18 and 40, between your friends, your family, the people you work with, and God, there's a separation. There's a break. There's a breach. Ba-pe-ris is the Hebrew word for it. It's a breach. You know what that means, Mary? It's not a space. It's not something where there was never anything there before. This is a break. There's a section here, and there's a section here. There's a section here, and there's a section here. Okay? This is a break. That's not what a gap is. A gap is this. Son, can you get up, please? And can you remove this chair and put it over there? That's a breach. That's a gap. That's a what's being talked about here. There was a chair there. There's supposed to be a chair there. There's a chair that belongs there that isn't there. These are supposed to be his children. These are supposed to be his people. Every single one of your family members and friends, they are supposed to be saved. They're supposed to be redeemed. They're supposed to be blessed. They're supposed to be part of God's family. And they're not. And God's looking for somebody who will stand in the gap. That's you guys. Will you? Book of Esther says that people are raised up for a certain time and a certain season in history. And I believe if God has led you to this church at this time and you heard this message or you were part of family camp, God has raised you up for a time such as this. He wants to use you to transform lives and save these people. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, what you need is vision. What you need God to do is give you vision. To fill your mind, to fill your heart, to drive your will with his imagery, with his word, with things that he says to you, with things that he shows you. If you want that, with every eye shut, I ask you to raise your hand. And I ask you to raise your hand as high in the air as you want to be used by God. If you are presbyteros, you want to be used by God to support and help young people. If you are between the age of 18 and 40, you want to be used by God to be sent out and change the world and change your family. Lift your hand as high as you want that to be. Father, in Jesus' name, give us vision. Say that with me. In the name of Jesus, give me vision. In the name of Jesus, give me vision. Lord, in the name of Jesus, give me vision. Let me see what you see. Let me feel what you feel. Let me hear what you hear. Share with me your heart and your mind. And direct me and show me what it is to do. And I give you praise and I give you thanks. Change my life forever from this moment on. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen. Amen. Thanks for coming. See you Wednesday.